about the communities and the region, and we'll try to see whether that stereotypes are being carried forward to the contemporary period, and try to try to redefine or redefine the communities in the contemporary period. What I'm trying to say, what I'm trying to look at the whole thing is about the, was there something called the Muslim contribution to the economic development? Particularly, was there something called capitalist development during the Muslim rule? This I'm trying to argue on the basis that we have a particular notion, Muslims have not contributed much to the economic development. They were basically feudals, in the sense that look at two arguments, particularly the Soviet theologists. Their argument is that the Muslim rule introduced what is called the top-down feudalism. Feudalism would not allow any kind of spaces for new social formations. Feudalism would not allow any kind of liberation to the communities as such, because that it believes in caste oppression, for example, like that, or it believes in atrocities, it believes in the labor exploitation and other things. Which obviously, the whole question is that when did it start, this particular feudalism? Did they really, created a structure of feudalism as such? I'm trying to understand this one into the, this matter, taking into account the South India. South India, we had absolutely a few Muslim rulers, in that particular context, we have got what is called the historical amnesia. We have been following this historical amnesia. For example, if you look at our text, I'll go back to that later on. I look at our text, they don't refer to the, particularly those who are studying in Karnataka and other, they don't refer to the Nizam rule. They don't refer to the, what is that called, Bahamanist rule, Adil Shahist. They don't refer anything, because there's this is a deliberate amnesia. There's a deliberate amnesia wherein they try to project Nizam's rule as basically as anti-people and anti-modernist, it was more conservative and most oppressive kind of thing, without taking into account that Nizam also did play in the economic transformation of Karnataka, particularly his contribution to the Tungabhadra Dam. You know that Tungabhadra Dam is bigger than the famous KRS dam in Karnataka. Its total capacity is 134 TMC, which is much more than the KRS kind of thing. And also the, a bridge across the, other things across the Krishna River. The whole thing is projected in such a way that it's not only simple Karnataka alone, it's everywhere. For example, Mughal rule. Mughal rule was particularly for scholars like Ulyanovsky and Pavlov, was basically feudal, top-down feudal, because they did not provide any kind of new economic things to grow, and there wasn't any kind of liberation as such. If you come to Tipu Sultan's rule, Tipu Sultan, why I'm trying to say that there are two kinds of argument with regard to the Tipu Sultan. One is that, which is quite obvious, that given the fact that he has been projected as a bad ruler, he has been projected as the oppressor, he has been projected as a person who has converted large number of Christians or the Kurgis or the Nayus, into Islam and other things. That's the reason why he was projected in that way. And the text basically. What I'm trying to say that, look at here, the textual argument which are trying to create what is called a stereotype, again and again about the Tipu Sultan. But in fact, the other side has not been taken into account, Tipu's. I know one thing is about the contribution. I think the second important thing is about the kind of capitalist development in Karnataka or in the capitalist development across the state as such. You know, in fact, there is an argument by Guha and others saying that it was during the Tipu Sultan period, some of the elements of the capitalist development was introduced. Even though there are people who would say that no, capitalist development came only after the invasion or what is after the British occupied India post 1800, particularly 1830, they would say. But in fact, if you go back to history, I'm trying to look at this particular Karnataka, why Karnataka became later on for Gandhi, it's a Ram Rajya, became an ideal state. Later on, mainly because of the kind of contribution that Tipu made, particularly in the field of agriculture, in the field of commercial crops and other crops, like for example the silk that he brought in, he introduced it. At the same time, he emancipated large number of Dalits who became the agricultural laborers as well as the rural cultivators, and that's the reason why if you look at these two aspects, and the labor was literally free in a sense. There is no bonded kind of thing that that was introduced during the Tipu's period, and also the way he tried to discipline the mutt temples and the upper caste in terms of disciplining in terms of the exploitation, in terms of labor exploitation, other things, which obviously mean that Tipu was trying to create a new social relation at the grassroots level, which obviously means that Tipu was trying to create capitalist development in agriculture, which that's the reason why post 1830 onwards, you could see the series of development taking place in Karnataka, including the places like the Tanjore and other places, that obviously means that you have this contribution coming from Muslim ruler, which has not been documented. That's the reason I'm saying that this absence is called as a historical amnesia. That's one first particular historical amnesia. Second important thing, amnesia, when it comes to the question of regions, you need to go back to the history also. Particularly when you look at the kind of communal riots taking place in the Indian context and the history of, riots and the conflict in Indian context. That's basically, largely we try to say that the communal riots and the communal conflicts are basically North India phenomena, beginning with the 17th century or the 18th century. But even though there are people who try to say that communalism was very much apparent in the context of the Mughal period, when the Jats, they destroyed the Muslim of what's called Akbar, that would call it as a peasant struggle. Many times there is a attempt to confuse the peasant struggle with peasant struggle and the communal conflict as almost the same kind of thing. Like for example, the way popular revolt, that obviously why I'm trying to say that, look at popular revolt can be documented as one of the historical struggles that the Muslims have waged. This is not the only thing that they have waged in history, but also in the context of the 18th century, particularly between 1730 and 1780, you have got the Fakir and Wahhabi movement taking place in the northern India, which obviously mean that the Muslims were at the forefront, or even take the case of 1857, when the ulemas issued fatwa against the British rule. I mean, they said that we should overthrow the British imperialism or colonialism, whatever it may be. That obviously, that Muslim literally took part in these politics. But the thing is that, why did South India, particularly if you look at the kind of regions that was developed in Indian context, you know, you have got multiple regions. You know, in fact, if you look at the South India, you don't find a single region as homogeneous region. If the argument is that regions are homogeneous, then obviously it is a myth. You know, you have got different regions, whether, you know, Tamil Nadu or Karnataka or Kerala and other things. You have these different regions, but the thing is that why this particular region has not witnessed severe communal riots when compared to the North India? Probably there is a kind of historical myth that has been played here. I'm trying to look at the whole historical amnesia here in terms of the presence of syncretic culture. Two things I need to understand. One is the cultural differences, absence of the cultural differences or that operating in Karnataka or in the South India. That's one thing. The second is the kind of syncretic culture that was constructed or created in the South Indian context. And I would say that look at the contribution of the Sufi saints. You know, particularly who came, you know, in fact, as yesterday, chief guest was telling, the Islam never came only through the conquer, through the military forces, but also through the, you know, merchant classes, or it also came through the, what is called the syncretic culture, Sahabas, it came through the Sahabas, or those who are associated with the Prophet, and the those who are associated with the, you know, you know, Makkah, the politics and other things. So it came as a merchant class, as well as, you know, as well as a syncretic culture. You know, let me tell you one important story that Banerjee has, you know, narrated in one of the, you know, articles recently, particularly why, you know, conversion has taken place. You know, the whole argument in the Indian context, the conflict is basically is a reaction to the severe conversion that has taken place in Indian context during the medieval period. So, but the thing is that did it happen in the case of the Karnataka or in the case of the, you know, coastal belt? You know, let me tell you about the story that, you know, Banerjee talked about with regard to the Koikod. You know, Koikod, why the large number of Muslims are located in Koikod, Calicut? You know, there is a story behind that. A small story, but the most important also. The story is that when Portuguese came to India, they came as a merchant classes. You might be knowing about the fact that they came. They wanted to capture this particular region, coastal belt, knowing very well that the coastal belt is known for the spice and other things. So when they came, they had a negotiation with the Zamorin, if I'm right, to establish their concern. But the thing is that when they established, or when they came for the, you know, business purpose, they found that nobody was willing to come forward to take or to buy their you know, sambo or the spices and other things. And they tried to find out what is the reason behind that. You know, strangely, they found that the people are not forthcoming because that they were all tacked to the or tied up with the caste conflict or the caste relations. You know, particularly, you know, if you look at the Nayars or anybody, for example, or the lower caste people, they are completely forbidden to, you know, visit a marketplace. They were completely forbidden to do any kind of exchange with the upper caste or even in the urban areas. You know, you remember that there was a kind of emancipation, you know, done by the what's called the Tipu Sultan, particularly the women folk in the context of the Malabar. You might be knowing about that. But even though, look at here, they were not allowed to enter into the market. They were not allowed to what is called the do the business with anybody else. That was the time when they found out that because of the caste stigma, they were not being allowed. So that's the reason why the Portuguese were losing, you know, what's called the profit. Their business was, you know, not growing. Then they requested the king that issue an ordinance saying that all the lower caste people can convert either to Christianity or to the Islam. You know, 1499, I think, when he issued the ordinance, next year the business multiplied. You know, the conversion was basically, it was not the conversion for the purpose of escaping from the caste thing. That is a popular myth. But rather, conversion was allowed to do the business. That's quite obvious in the context of the, you know, Calicut and other places. But in other places, if you look at, or if you read the history of the medieval period, particularly in the North India and also the South India, conversion was, in South India, conversion was not a major issue, barring three places like, for example, the Coorg, Malabar, and Mangalore, which became well known for the, you know, contesting the history. And that became the part of the contemporary politics also. I'm trying to look at that. You don't have the conversion everywhere taking place. Look at even in the city like Srirangpatna, where Tipu ruled. That was not, even you know, the temple was across his palace and it did not do anything. It did not destroy that one. You know, if you look at Tipu's contribution, let me tell you about that one. You know, two things basically important for me. One is that he created what is called the modern notion of Karnataka, which has not been updated, which has not been delivered to us. Like his father and son, they integrated the modern Karnataka. There were nearly 200 principalities in Karnataka, different parts of Karnataka. They were loggerheads with each other. They were, you know, trying to, you know, usurp the power and other things. They defeated 200 small oligarchs. 200, remember, and that's the reason why you have this modern existence of Karnataka came into being, beginning from, you know, crossing Kaveri up to Rajur, and then you have this, I think, even Arcot and other places. That's the reason why, you know, his contribution of a modern Karnataka is not been documented properly. That's the reason why I call it as a part of the historical amnesia. But at the same time, this conversion, this supposed to have converted large number of, you know, Nayars or the Christians or the Kurgis in Karnataka, which has been seen as a part of the communal politics in the contemporary period. But in fact, if you read, was he a communal? The first question is about whether he was a communal. In fact, if you read the latest article, a couple of months back, a historian like Vikar Ahmed wrote an article on Tipu again. He says that the Tipu, he not only contributed to the myths, you know, might be knowing about the fact that Tipu was the one who contributed much gift to the Shankaracharya Pita in Sringeri, and a large number of temples, like for example Nanjangud temples and other things. But the thing is that Tipu also contributed, which is not being documented properly, around 700 acres of land to Guru Ayur temple. And remember, that was, now also you can go, you know, the moment you go there, you'll get the documents about that one. But the question is that Tipu, more than Hyderabad, is being projected badly. But the thing, why did he convert these people? Was it because, you know, that he was interested to convert India into an Islamic country? Even though he was very close to, he'll write letters to what's called the Khalifa and trying to, you know, get the legitimacy for his rule and other things, but he was more of an internationalist. When the French Revolution took place, he was the one who planted a tree called the Freedom Tree. And remember, because of the political exigencies, particularly, you know, in Kurg, the large number of Kurgis were resorting to what is called the guerrilla war, and they were coming in the way of, you know, Tipu's expansionism, and that's the way Tipu had no other, you know, way but to silence them. That's reason why he resorted to the, you know, conversion. Nair, the same case, is a political reasons he converted. But in the case of the, you know, Christians, there's a mismatch in the argument as well as in the case of your own empirical evidences. Like they say that nearly 30,000 Christians were converted, but it was, you know, untrue. It was completely wrong in that case. But the thing is, look at these communal issues have been harped on or been taken into account, trying to say that, look, you know, these Muslim rulers were the most communal. But they, remember, I think the Adil Shah is very, you know, very close to the Sufism. The Sufi culture or their writings on a syncretic culture, you know, is much more, which has not been, you know, told to everybody. You know, the second important thing is when you talk about the Sufism, there's one contribution which has not been taken into account, which has literally helped the, I would call it as a capitalist development in Karnataka and in the whole of South India also. You know, coffee economy was a contribution of the Sufism. You know, you might be knowing about the Baba Budangiri. Baba Budangiri, Dada Hak Halandu, was a Sufi. He came from Yemen. And Yemen, he brought three, and particularly a place called the Mocha. He brought three seeds of coffee. And he planted that when he you know, put the seeds in around you know, Chikmagalur, and it flourished. Remember, coffee economy has grown as a capitalist economy. Look at one side, you have you know, Tipu Sultan helping the growth of the capitalist economy, particularly, you know, by bringing the mulberry, silk worm and other things, and at the same time going for what's called the drastic, you know, changes in the socio-economic relations. You know, creating a free labor category, you know, freeing the bonded laborers, particularly the Dalits, making the Dalits owner cultivators and other things. And he was creating more than, I would call it as a commercial, more than a commercialization, I would call it as a capitalist development, you know, trying to subscribe to the argument of guna. The second important people who brought in capitalist development was Sufis. Remember, particularly Dada Hayat Kalandar in the context of Karnataka, it was spread across different regions in South India. But the thing is that Sufism created the syncretic culture. Remember, why I'm trying to say that, look at the, if you look at the region, or region particularly South India, South India is completely, up till recently, bereft of any communal rights, communal tension. For us, the communal tension began after 1960s, 1970s or somewhere, particularly after 1980s or the 1990s, it became what's called a severe problem in South India. There are two or three reasons. But before that, one, you should understand the fact that Sufism, you know, created a what is called a fuzzy community. If you look at the fuzzy community, which can be called as a very, very abstract community. Like, for example, let me give an example of Mios in the Haryana. Or even in the case of the Karnataka also, you got the people who carries the Hindu names, but incidentally, they are all Muslims. Like, for example, somebody is known as Fakirappa. He, you know, Fakir is always identified as a common man. So if you look at that one, probably it is true that they created a synthesis of the communities. This synthesis of community created what's called the abstract communities. They are not, you know, community which can be demarcated in terms of the clear-cut category. Like, for example, in the case of the Mios, for example, Mios, they say that they're all Muslims, but they are what's called the the family god is Krishna. So you have this, you know, two categories, two religion, two communities. They are coexisting together. Probably the same kind of thing happened in the case of the Karnataka and the southern part. One is the involvement of the rulers, writing on romanticism, writing on the, you know, Allah and the Krishna, particularly, if I'm right, in the case of the rulers of the Gulbarga and others. And at the same time, you have the communal harmony being taken up and created. And at the same time, the second important question is that when the conversion took place, did they forget about this, the what's called the caste identity, which can be taken up a little later? But the thing is that given the fact that you don't have this clear-cut demarcation of the communities in terms of the cultural practices, in terms of the identity, in terms of the existence, obviously it has not led to what is called the communalism to take place deep inside. Even though what I earlier referred to what is called the, you know, popular revolt what's called somebody, some foreign, I mean, particularly Western scholars, they would try to say that, popular revolt was basically a revolt of the Hindus and the Muslims, popular versus the Namudari. But I would say that it's more of peasant in nature, particularly the peasantry were oppressed by the upper caste or the landed gentry. That's the reason why that cannot be treated as a, in terms of the communal identity as such, even though that was a part of the Khilafat movement and others, whatever it may be. But the thing is that the absence of any communal conflict or the communal identities in the history prohibited any kind of communal rights in India, and particularly in South India. So that's the reason why when India got independence, particularly in 1947, at the time of, you know, independence, that was celebrated by the South Indians as the independence, but the North Indians, that was a day of partition. That was the day of partition. But the thing is that South India never experienced the fallout of the partition. One thing is that South Indians, they never moved to Pakistan. The second, South Indian never witnessed any kind of communal riots during 1947 partition period. For the South Indians, for the Muslims, that's the reason why Muslims never became the victims. Because the history, the kind of region that they created, the secular identity that they created, tolerance society that created, the mutual respect that they created, they all stopped this kind of communal feeling, you know, getting into this psyche of politics. That's the reason why 1947, for us, the partition was a textual reference. For us, it was a, you know, textual argument more than the actual feeling. We never felt the experience of what kind of, you know, communal rights that take place, or how do you look at the what's called the partition as a division between the two countries, two communities and other things. That's the reason why for us communal riots or the communal ill-feeling or communal ideology is the late karma. Particularly it is a post-independence phenomenon, and that too, I think the post-1980s phenomenon. And except in coastal belt, look at, for example, like the coastal belt of the Mangalore. You might be knowing about that Mangalore. Bakkal, Mangalore, Udupi and other things. They are being called as the laboratory of the communal rights. Since Pajir is presenting a paper on Bali community, I need to tell you one thing about that one. Bali community as a merchant class, initially they started as a small merchant class and later on they became a very big merchant classes. Look at, there are different reasons why this communal rights has come up in this particular region, or this coastal belt has become what is called the communally sensitive, or what is called the laboratory of the communalism. Because one thing is that we never had this experience. If you look at the syncretic culture in the coastal belt, whether it's a Ullala Madini Dargah or other Dargahs in the coastal belt, including the syncretism that was created in that particular locality, that prohibited the communal rights. For example, there's a temple called the Bappanadu Temple. I don't know how many of you know about this, but a temple called the Bappanadu Temple in a place called the Mulki, nearby Mangalore. This is a temple, but actually constructed by a Muslim guy, Muslim, merchant. And that's the reason why if there is any kind of festival, first thing they have to do is to go and give what is called the, betel nuts to the family of the Bappa Bai. Even ghost, Hindu ghost, but basically were the Arab ghost. Shaitan, you call it as shaitan. Hindu shaitan, they are not the Hindu shaitan, they are actually the Arab shaitan. There is a shaitan called Babbariya. If you go to the history, the Babbariya was a man who was an Arab merchant. And he was the one who helped these Maghavira communities, the fisheries communities. And that's the reason why, prevented the large-scale losses to the Maghavira community. And they started worshipping him. Remember, this Arab merchant became God in a way. He is a shaitan, but God. But remember, that's the reason why this lower caste never been a part of this communal rights. Historically, if you look at Karnataka or the Tamil Nadu anyway, Karnataka, we had the first communal rights in 1920s. We never had this communal rights during the Tipu period, or Nizam Shahi period, or even Adil Shahi period. Nowhere. We never had this experience because that this region was constructed in such a way that culturally there is no differences, politically there is no differences in terms of the ascriptive or the differences in terms of the what's called the arguments and other things, and even in the history also, unlike in the North India, our history is completely different. And at the same time, our history is slightly different in the sense that when it comes to the question of the caste identities, probably we try to, cover up or try to amalgamate or to integrate our caste identities into an Islamic identity. So Islam, the process of Islamization in the coastal belt, in the South India is much more pronounced one when compared to the North India. For example, look at the medieval period in the North Karnataka, North India. If you go by the census report of 1931, 1901 and other, here this caste census taking place. In the caste census, it is said that there are a large number of gotras, which is almost like a caste. Even though the whole debate about the caste took place even in the medieval period in India, the 10th century itself, in the court of a Muslim ruler, where the argument about the three-caste, emerging in Indian context, two-caste, particularly Ashraf and the non-Ashrafs. You know, if you look at the whole debate, I mean, if you look at the statistics of the census report of 1931, you find the large number of Muslims claiming that they all belong to different Gotras. But incidentally, we don't find this kind of Gotraization or the Gotra in the context of South India. I don't come across, when you're making some reference to the what's called the Bahmanis or anybody for that matter, nobody said that they're all Ashrafs. Nobody said that they're all the non-Ashrafs. In fact, there are three categories. One is the Ashraf, Arzals, and Arzals. The one is the first is the upper caste or upper class. Basically, they are the descendant of the Sayyid, or they are the pure Arab stocks or the Turkish stocks. They are the basically from the non-Indian category. And that they come here, they came here, they settled down. Their percentage is almost 5%. And interestingly, South Indian never used these categories, Ashraf, non-Ashraf category, or neither they talked about what is called the Gotra category. You know, if you read the Gotras, the Muslims should say that they belong to what's called the Suryavamshi, or they say that they are also what's called the Chandravamshi and other things. Everybody was talking typically about their Gotras. They are all proud to say that they are all the Jats. Now, I found not less than 450 Gotras among the Muslims in the North India. But we never came across such a thing in South India. I found only the argument about the Nawayats, the argument about the Sheikhs, Sunnis, all these things, not about the caste categorization. So there is an undifferentiated Muslim in the category in the context of the South India. So, and that's the reason why South Indian Muslim cannot be differentiated. They're all they come under the category called the Muslims. And probably that is one of the reasons why the argument of homogeneity can be found in the context of the South India than in the North India. Probably when they are creating a region, regions as pockets, regions as a space for the communities, they did not bring in these particular differences, the differences between the caste and the communities and other things. That's the reason why you've got a homogeneity of the Muslims, and that has not been translated as a communal, typical communal arguments, etc. This is the reason why, if you look at the history of South India, one is that we never experienced the caste atrocities, particularly among the Muslims. The second is that we don't find any kind of communal riots breaking up because of the historical reasons. One is that we have the syncretic culture operating. The second is about the tolerant society that we would able to create, particularly rulers, whether the Tipu or the rulers from the Gulbarga and other regions, Adil Shahis and others. So the third is that there's a cultural affinity among the people. So this is the reason why our region is becoming, it's literally a completely different kind of region when compared to the North India. So when North India is really under this kind of issues, severe conflict, severe communal issues, severe differences, the notion about the other being created there and other things, we never experienced that one. We never experienced, what's called alienation. We always feel that we are a part of this culture, we are a part of this setting and other things. That's the reason why we need to understand the historical development of the regions and the kind of ruler the kind of changes that they brought in here. You know, one change that I would say that we need to reconstruct the history in terms of reclaiming what's called the historical amnesia. Like, for example, the historical amnesia is about the capitalist development that the Muslim rulers created in the context of the South India. And that's the reason why the prosperity of the contemporary period also has to be dated back to the Muslim rule. That's one thing. The second is that the kind of syncretism that they created when compared to the North India is completely different. They did not convert anybody. No Sufi saint converted forcibly or otherwise the large number of Hindus or the Dalits and other things, barring political reasons. Probably that could be the reason why one side we need to reclaim the what's called the our history. The second is that we need to dismiss this kind of historical amnesia and try to rebuild our history in terms of the changes that has taken place in the contemporary period. Thank you very much.